The following program, Pilgrim's Progress, is sponsored by the National Prayer Chapel.
Four thousand years ago, there was a man who lived on the earth by the name of Abram. His wife's name was Sarai, meaning princess. This princess was beautiful to look at, but she could not have children. She was barren. Now, Abram had been called by God to leave his country, his family, and go to a land that the Lord was directing him to go to. Now, this was some 300 years after the great deluge, or the flood of Noah. People had spread all over the earth. Babylon had been established by Nimrod, the great hunter before the Lord. Nineveh had been established. The great cities of Mesopotamia had been established. And now God is calling Abram to leave Ur of the Chaldees and go to a land that he would show him. He was literally beginning to create and shape a nation. He was literally beginning to create and shape the womb through which God himself would be born. It would not surprise you then to know that God is going to deal with Abram in a most unusual manner. And yet I would suggest to you that the way God dealt with Abram is merely a model for how he will deal with your life as well. He calls all Christians, he calls all men of every faith and every religion to come before him at the judgment bar. We're told in the New Testament that only those who have received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, who have been willing to deny themselves, take up their cross, be crucified, and follow Jesus, will enter into the eternal dwellings. Now, that's not a popular belief to hold in our day. But you see, we have to come to a place where we understand that the beliefs of our day, the way we choose to live and actually live our life, is not the norm for how men have always lived their lives. There have come among us men at various times and women at various times who have exemplified the work of God in their lives, and they have served as models until the coming of Jesus Christ. And then the way he lived his life becomes the model for us. The two great commandments, to love God with all your heart, your mind, and your soul, and the second great command, to love your neighbor as yourself. These are the laws of the kingdom of God. Now, God only does things by covenant. The Bible, in fact, is separated into two different parts. The first we refer to as the Old Covenant, the second as the New Covenant. The word covenant literally means to cut. In other words, when a covenant was made, unlike a contract can be annulled, a contract can be amended. A covenant cannot be annulled and it cannot be amended. A covenant is forever. And so the covenant, God of heaven, uses that term, the cut, as he speaks about his agreement with man. Men would do the same. They would cut their hands and hold them together and mix the blood in a most solemn covenant, meaning that if either one of us break or do not fulfill the agreement of this covenant, their life will be forfeited. They will be killed. Blood will be shed. So this symbolic grasping of hands was simply to say, if you do not keep this covenant, you will die. Now, this concept of covenant, old and new, needs to be understood from another perspective. The new covenant we often speak of as beginning when Jesus died on the cross. But in truth, the new covenant is also known as the everlasting covenant. So the everlasting covenant stretches before the creation of man and stretches all the way through eternity. It never ceases. The everlasting covenant, or the new covenant, was made between the Father and the Son. It was made in the Godhead. We believe in one God who expresses himself in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. God made a covenant within God himself, and Jesus came to fulfill that covenant by shedding his blood. Because the covenant was that if the sons and daughters of Adam, if Adam and Eve themselves were to sin against God, God himself would become the sacrifice that would save them. That they would not shed their blood for the covenant being broken, because the covenant was not made between God and man. The everlasting covenant was made between God and God. And so God expressed himself in the person of Jesus, who existed from all eternity. Jesus, who was the creator God of the universe. Jesus, who is God. God himself had to come in the form of a man and pay the penalty for the sin that we had committed. That was the everlasting covenant. But there is an old covenant. But Abraham, or Abram as we still know him in the 13th chapter of Genesis, meaning exalted father, he is not under the old covenant. He is under the everlasting covenant. The old covenant will not be instituted until we come to the time of Moses. Now you're listening to Pilgrim's Progress. I'm Pastor Ray Greenlee from the National Prayer Chapel. Pilgrim's Progress was the story that John Bunyan wrote, the astonishing allegory, telling the story of Christian as he leaves the city of destruction and makes his way to the celestial city. We're using that format, if you please, to speak about Abram's life, looking at it from his being called out of the city of destruction, Ur of the Chaldees, the moon god center of worship, the occultic astrology worship. As he is called out of the city of destruction into the promised land, or the Cana land, his progress, I have to say, is slow. And most of us recognize the slowness of our own progress. We get caught up in the beliefs of our culture, and we are delayed. Abram was delayed in coming out of Ur of the Chaldees because his father insisted on coming, and his nephew Lot insisted on coming. And so these additional family members, against the word of the Lord, came with Abram as they moved toward the promised land. They ended up in Haran, which means a parched place. And the father of Abram, by the name of Terah, meant delay. It's important that as we look at this story, we recognize the passage of time and recognize a very sobering fact. The only life you're going to have to live is the life you are now living. You don't come and go around again. The Lord said it was for every man to live once and then face the judgment. And at the judgment, your eternal fate will be determined. This is not a judgment that I can cause to favor me against the will of God. God is a God of justice. He cannot be bribed. He does not show favoritism. He does not grade on the curve, depending on what culture you come from. He is a God of justice and righteousness. He is a God of wrath and of great love. Not unconditional love, but unfailing love. And so we find in this one life we have to live a very short window of opportunity as we are on probation before God to determine what our eternal fate will be. If we meet the conditions as outlined in the Word of God given to us by Jesus Christ, then we can enter into the kingdom of God. Do not be fooled by thinking, I am saved and I am safe. Only a lying teacher would tell you that. You have, as Paul speaks in Ephesians, the first chapter, the first deposit of the Holy Spirit. This is not a guarantee, as it is translated in the NIV. Rather, it is a time of probation. It is a time of most careful evaluation of your heart and your decisions. A young man, and I share it with you, let me open my phone very quickly. A young man texted me, and he said to me, I'm struggling to not run out into sin. Last night was tough for me. I'm reading scripture. I'm praying. I'm waiting to hear back from a job. I texted him back yesterday morning. The wages of sin are death. Don't offer your body to the devil. Offer your body to Jesus as a living sacrifice. You are not your own. You were bought at a price. He texted me back this morning. I didn't have sex, but I sinned with a woman last night. I'm trying to hope in God against the sentence of death I have put on myself. I text him back this morning. Hope in God will not save you from a sure sentence of death. Only confession and true reformation can, by the blood of Jesus, save you. Now, these are hard words I've spoken. But you see, God is not sentimental. We're only going to go through this life one time. And at the end of whatever period of time God has given to us, we will face the judgment bar of God. And if we have not received the real righteousness of Jesus in our lives so that it is demonstrably lived out day by day, we will not enter into the kingdom of heaven. And our journey will be aborted, and we will not reach the promised land. Now, I hope you sense by the conviction of the Holy Spirit how serious this matter is that we're looking at today. Do not be deceived, believing, as one dear person was who said, "My heart is filled with pride. My life is about pride. I think about myself and I talk about myself all the time, but I'm saved. So I know I'm okay with Jesus. I just have a heart filled with pride." Well, this dear person has been listening to preaching that tells her that all she must do is receive Jesus Christ and she is saved. We are not saved by receiving Jesus Christ. We are saved by Jesus Christ receiving us. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? But you say, "Pastor, what about the grace of God?" The grace of God is unmerited favor. The grace of God is in Titus, being taught how to say no and given the power to say no to ungodliness. A person who walks in ungodliness has resisted the grace of God, has cast it aside as something cheap and empty. God is not looking to take to heaven sinners. He is only going to take the righteous to heaven, not righteous by proxy, but righteous for real. This is the gift that is being offered to you. If you are a sinner today, hear the cry of my heart. Jesus is offering to give you as a free gift his righteousness. And it will cause you to be crucified. It will cause you to enter into his sufferings. It will cost you to fast and pray and seek after Jesus with all of your heart. It will cause you to say no to worldliness and ungodliness. It will cause you to say no to the many entertainments of our day, including the lounges, including the clubs, including the entertainment of the professional sports world. It will cause you to turn aside from all of these things. It will cause you to cry out before God until the full righteousness of Jesus has been planted firmly in your heart and you've been brought into that everlasting covenant of grace. We do not enter heaven by our works. We enter into heaven by the righteousness of Jesus Christ, but it is real righteousness that infuses the very life and body and soul of a man or woman. A man or woman with no moral fiber should not expect to enter into the kingdom of God. A man or woman who chooses not to say no to the lust of the flesh cannot be saved. The power to say no to the lust of the flesh, to pride, to anger, to bitterness, to stealing, to hating, The power to say no to all of these things is found in the blood of Jesus Christ. So we come now to the story of Abram in the 13th chapter of the book of Genesis. He has been kicked out of Egypt. He has been told that he must flee Egypt. He has been told that it is not possible for him to continue. And so Lot and Abram come together. They fight, or Lot fights through his herdsmen with Abram. They separate. Lot goes to Sodom, and he's now moved in, and he is sitting at the gate of the city. If you read in the New Testament, the book of Peter, you find that Lot was a righteous man and that his heart was greatly grieved by the wickedness of Sodom. But I have to ask, why did he remain then in Sodom? Why didn't he go and live with Abram in the oaks of Mamre? Why didn't he flee to Hebron, the house of God, to Bethel? Why did he remain? Because of his financial advantage. So he placed himself in the way. And so now we have Abram without his family, and the word of God comes to him in chapter 15 and says, "Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield," or "I am your sovereign. I am your king. I am your very great reward." But Abram has an accusation against God. He says, "O sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless and the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus?" Now you understand, he's been living in this land now for 10 years. Time is passing. His life is going by. He is already middle-aged and moving toward old age. And he's saying to God, "You have not given me a son, and you promised me one." And the word of the Lord came to him in great mercy and said in verse 4, "This man will not be your heir, but a son coming from your own body will be your heir." He took him outside. "Look up at the heavens and count the stars, if indeed you can count them." Then he said to him, "So shall your offspring be." In verse 6, Abram believed the Lord, and he credited to him as righteousness. In other words, righteousness, real righteousness, is coming under the new or under the everlasting covenant. It is entering into Abram's heart. But he's not there yet. Listen to what Abram says next. "O sovereign Lord, how can I know that I will gain possession of it?" The Lord is promising him that he will give him the whole land, that he's brought him out of Ur of the Chaldees with a decision made in the heavens that everything would be given to him. And he's saying, "Okay, I can believe you for a son, but how do I know I'm going to gain possession of this land?" He was a very wealthy man, but he had nowhere near enough money to buy that land from the Canaanites. He had no power to kick them out of the land. Now, how could he possibly believe God for this? So the Lord said to him, "Bring me a heifer, a goat, and a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon." Abram brought all these things to him, He cut them in two and arranged the halves opposite each other. The birds, however, he did not cut in half. And then birds of prey came down on the carcasses, but Abram drove them away. What I want you to see is that Abram has done something that was common in that day in the making of a covenant. Instead of cutting their palms and joining hands, they took precious animals, cut those animals in half, and put them a little distance apart in a straight line. Now, God did not have him just do a heifer, which would have been sufficient. Instead, he also had him go the next step, and he takes a goat and a ram and a dove and a young pigeon. He brings all of the offerings that can be offered before God. He cuts them in half. He separates them, all but the birds. He waits on God now. I want to tell you, the most painful part of my journey has been waiting on God. He has everything arranged. He now waits for God to come. He doesn't know yet what will be required of him. As the sun is setting, Abram falls into a deep sleep, and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. And now, in a dream, or even perhaps a vision, the Lord says to him, "Know for certain that your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own. They will be enslaved and mistreated 400 years. But I will punish the nation they serve as slaves. And afterward they will come out with great possessions. You, however, will go to your fathers in peace and be buried at a good old age. In the fourth generation, your descendants will come back here, for the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure." I want to just stop one moment. The Lord has said something that you need to hear very clearly. God was not ready to bring judgment upon the Amorites because they had not yet filled up their cup of wickedness. A few moments ago, I read you the text of a young man. This young man is, day after day, filling up his cup of wickedness. We know from many places in the scriptures, I give you the example of Eli's sons, who, as they were serving at the tabernacle of meeting, the tent of meeting in Shiloh, would sexually play with the women who worked for the Lord at the tabernacle, taking advantage of them. They treated the sacrifices with contempt, taking the meat before it was offered or before it was boiled, taking the best parts for themselves. Eli was warned about this matter, but he enjoyed his filet mignon, and he enjoyed the benefits of the son's sins against God. And the Lord came by a prophet, and then by the little boy Samuel, and pronounced judgment on Eli and on his sons. Eli's attitude was, "Let the Lord do whatever the Lord will do. He is God." It was the will of God to take the lives of both of his sons because their cup of iniquity had been filled up. This young man whose text I read to you today is rapidly filling up his cup of iniquity, and when it is full, his life will be forfeit. I pause to ask you the question, have you filled up your cup of iniquity? Are you filling up your cup so that there will be no more forbearance before God, no more patience on the part of God regarding the wickedness of your life? Do you believe that you can continue to walk in your wickedness and somehow everything is going to be okay because you hope that God will have mercy on you? Or you have been told that you're free to walk in your sin because when Jesus looks at you, he doesn't see you, he sees himself. It's utter foolishness. God will tolerate only so much wickedness in a man's life, and then his life is forfeit. Some of you will go to your graves at a ripe old age, and you will have filled up your cup of wickedness, and you will stand before the judgment bar of God and be cast into hell. For some of you, it will take, in the patience and the foreknowledge of God, a great length of time to fill up your cup of iniquity. Others of you will fill your cup very quickly, and God will simply cut you off. These are very hard things to understand. I hope what I'm sharing with you causes your heart to tremble before God, for he is the judge. God would not allow Abram and his descendants to come in and execute judgment on the Canaanites until they had utterly filled up their cup of iniquity. When Babylon filled up their cup of iniquity, Medo-Persia came in and took over the kingdom. When Medo-Persia had filled up its cup as the second great empire of the world, then came Greece. When Greece filled up its cup, then came Rome. Today, according to Daniel, the second chapter, we are in the toes. We are in the feet of that great image. And now a one-world government is emerging. America has almost filled up its cup. And the judgments of God are beginning to be poured out upon us. And America will play its final role in giving its military support to the one world government, to the Antichrist, to the man of iniquity, who even now, I'm sure, lives among us and is arising. I was shocked to hear that Bill Clinton, former President Bill Clinton, had received an award of being the Father of the Year. That's beyond comprehension that a philanderer, a sexual deviant, a man of utmost sin, should be lifted up in America and used as an example of what fathers should be. It is a sign of the deviant wickedness of America, and the judgments of God are coming now upon this nation. Don't be surprised when there are great earthquakes rending apart our nation. Don't be surprised if this year there is a complete economic failure, if prices skyrocket. Don't be surprised at the storms that will come. at the bitterness of the cold this winter, don't be surprised. God is beginning to pour out his judgments that will bring famine and death and destruction, because America has filled up his cup of wickedness. So the Lord continues. Verse 17, when the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoldering firepot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. In other words, God himself came as fire, as a blazing torch, and he walked between those animals. He walked in the blood of those animals, and he made a covenant by blood with Abram. Remember, he's answering the question, how do I know that I will possess this land? Because God made a blood covenant with Abram and his descendants. And today in our age, we live in a time when the President of the United States desires to force Israel to divide Jerusalem. We live in a day when the President of our United States refuses to recognize Jerusalem as the capital because he denies the God of heaven. He scorns the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He scorns Jesus Christ. And this too will bring rapid judgments upon America. When America tries to force Israel to give up land to the Palestinians or to anyone else, when Israel is under pressure to give away the Golan Heights, to become defenseless. All of this has been prophesied, and all of this is filling up the cup of destruction of those nations who would dare take that position against the God of Israel, who made a blood covenant with Abram and his descendants regarding this land and its possession by them. So the Lord made a covenant with Abram, and he said, to your descendants, I give this land from the river of Egypt to the great river, the Euphrates, the land of the Kenites, Kenizzites, Kadamites, Hittites, Perizzites, Rephaites, Amorites, Canaanites, Girgashites, and Jebusites. This whole land, we refer to it as the Holy Land, because God said it was his land, and he was only loaning it. He was only renting it to Abram and his descendants. And he was giving Abram possession of this great land. Now I have to stop and recognize that God is a God of covenant. He only operates by covenant. It is a covenant of holiness, of righteousness, of Christ-likeness. It is not a covenant of prosperity, burning righteousness. It is a covenant that Jesus Christ paid the final price for on Calvary, that we could be made like Jesus. He was a sacrifice of atonement to bring us back into fellowship with Jesus Christ. The Lord will not have patience with a man or a woman who says, I'm doing the best I can do. I'm sorry, I cannot overcome my sin. He will not have patience because Jesus overcame the sin on Calvary's tree. And everything that is necessary for salvation has been poured out for us. It's simply a matter of whether we will meet the conditions. Now I tell you, I am beseeching the throne of God that he would once more come down, that he would once more come and with the fullness of the covenant made complete at the death of Jesus, the coming of the Holy Spirit in revival power to claim that which is his own. And so I ask you today, where are you in this pilgrim journey? How are you walking before God? Are you walking righteous and clean by the power of the blood? Or are you making excuses for your sin? I have to come and say to you, I have no excuse for my sin. And I confess freely and openly that my sin will take me to hell unless it is fully repented of, confessed before the Almighty God, and allow the Holy Spirit to come in and transform and make new. And I come to you today knowing that my heart and my life is clean before Jesus because I will not sin against him. I know that if I do sin, I have an advocate with the Father who will speak on my behalf. But I also know that that confession will involve a full work of cleansing, of purifying, of making holy. God is looking for a people who will give up their lives, who will become living martyrs, who will seek only the face of Jesus, who will no longer walk in cheap grace before God, thumbing their nose at his righteousness, claiming that they belong to him and are saved, even as they're in the midst of their wickedness. Our phone number in studio is 877-534-0780. I just know in my spirit today that there are many listening to this broadcast who are very sober right now before God. Some of you need to call and simply ask for prayer and repent and make an agreement that you will meet the conditions of Jesus Christ to deny yourself, to take up your cross and to follow him. Others of you, a much smaller number of you, have made that covenant. And you are walking clean by his grace before Jesus. I praise God for you. It doesn't matter whether you're a pastor, a minister, an evangelist, a layperson, whoever you are, God is no respecter of persons. I've known many pastors walking before the Lord in complete ungodliness, in pride and arrogance, dealing with the church as if it were a business, speaking no words of rebuke for sin, not in any manner calling people to righteousness, but rather reassuring them that in their sin, they're okay. God is calling for something new today. He's calling you to make a covenant with him, to repent of your sins, and to allow him to make you righteous by the shed blood of Jesus. Again, our phone number is 877-534-0780. We have just a few minutes left in this broadcast. I'm going to give you some information now about how you can reach the National Prayer Chapel. Our mailing address is Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. If your heart is convicted by the word that you hear day by day on this broadcast, then I ask you to respond to the call of God and join me in supporting this ministry. The National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. We meet on Sunday afternoons at 12:30 at the All Saints Anglican Church. It's located at 14851 Gideon Drive. That's 14851 Gideon Drive in Woodbridge, Virginia, 22192. You're also welcome to go to the podcast and download podcasts as you choose. Go to nationalprayerchapel.com. Welcome, Earlette. What would you like to share today?
Hi, Pastor Ray. Thank you for taking my call. This is political, but of course you are open and are aware of and speak political also, right? The last straw is the National Cathedral marrying homosexuals, as far as I'm concerned. The National Cathedral is a landmark. You know, it's where we have funerals for dignitaries, presidents. It's where we come together after 9/11. This is just totally sinful and an abomination to our Abba Father. It's just disgusting, frankly, right?
Earlette, I spoke about this yesterday.
Oh, did you? I missed part of the show.
And you're absolutely correct. It is literally giving God the finger.
Exactly.
That's exactly what it is.
Yeah.
It is scorning everything that God has done for this nation.
Yeah.
And it is an abomination before him, and it will result in God's judgment on Washington, D.C.
Yeah, really. I mean, who hasn't gone to the cathedral or taken an out-of-town guest or gone on Christmas, you know?
I've gone many times to the cathedral to sit and pray.
Right.
I will never again do that.
Yeah. Well, my prayer would be, and you guide it, that there would be one or two in leadership that would recognize that this the error of the sin here. I don't care what denomination. I don't care if they're Episcopalian.
The Episcopal Church has utterly cast Jesus out. There are bishops in the Episcopal Church today who would not even acknowledge the historical reality of Jesus Christ. Mm. They would say that it was the Jesus principle that mattered. They worship the goddess of the earth, the mother god. They have utterly abandoned orthodoxy.
Well.
And the judgment of God is now coming upon them. And one of the signs of that judgment coming, according to Romans, the first chapter, is being given over to homosexuality. Now, I'm not judging homosexuals. I'm simply saying that particular sin has been red flagged in Scripture,
right,
as a sign of the final judgment of God that is about to be poured out on a nation or a person.
Right. Well, but the prayer of the righteous man availeth much. So let's pray, if we could, dear sir, that if we send letters or emails or faxes, that, you know, they might just say, hey, this is a community, this is an area that we have been called out and noticed that this is not biblical or right in our
Earlette,
city.
The Lord will not let me pray that prayer.
No? Okay.
Instead, what I pray is for the salvation of the precious members of the Episcopal Church who are caught in this denomination's wickedness. And I pray for a coming out of Babylon.
Right.
I would pray for an entire change in the ownership of the National Cathedral. Mm-hmm. I would pray that it could be taken over by a godly denomination.
Yes, Father. Yes,
but I cannot pray for the leadership of the Episcopal Church.
Okay. Well, let's just pray for the National Cathedral then, the leadership there then, if we could.
Lord Jesus, we just come praying together.
Yeah.
Asking, Lord, for the salvation of the men and women who are caught in this web called Episcopalian. Lord, we do pray for their leaders, for their salvation, for their redemption.
Yes.
But, Lord, I pray specifically that the cathedral could be taken from out of this wicked denomination, that it could be utterly destroyed, and that a new godly organization could be placed in charge of this wonderful landmark. Lord, I pray for your will to be done in Washington, D.C.
Yes.
I pray, Lord, over the White House, your mercy. I pray for President Obama today. Lord, I pray your mercy for this man, that he could come to a realization of who you are as Jesus, the Lord and Savior, that he would turn aside from the beliefs he holds and flee to the throne of mercy. And Lord, I pray for our senators and congressmen. Lord, as they're now involved in decisions regarding the Second Amendment.
Yes, yes.
I pray, Lord, that they will not plunge America into civil war. Lord, I see that out of chaos, the New World Order would like to bring their order. Lord, I plead for time yet for men and women to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ and to be brought into fellowship with you, Jesus.
Yes.
So we pray for peace in America. Lord, we pray against all violence.
Yes.
And ask your mercy to redeem us. I pray for revival once more in this nation, that your presence would come down and a revelation of your holiness could be made. I pray this in the name of Jesus.
Yes. Repentant. Help them to recognize they the repentant, because they're repentant, unrepentant.
Yes, Lord. We pray in your name.
Yes.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Earlette.
Thank you, God.
Where do you stand today on these issues that I've been speaking about? And particularly, I ask, have you entered into the covenant of the death of Jesus Christ? Have you been covered by his blood? Have you been made righteous by his blood? Have you totally turned aside from the world? Are you no longer filling your cup of wickedness, but rather having it washed away by the precious blood of Jesus? How do you stand before the throne of God today? God bless you. I'll talk with you soon.